Hi, let's talk about how the heart works. Your heart has its own cycle of relaxation and contraction. Diastole is what we call relaxation, and systole is what we call contraction. Now, during diastole, you can think of diastole as dilation of the heart. What happens is that the myocardium of your atria and ventricles relax. And as a consequence, blood returning from the body and the lungs gets pulled into and through the atria and into the ventricles. About 3/4 of the blood that's squeezed out of the heart during systole is going to enter the ventricles during diastole. Following diastole, your atria are going to contract. And so what happens there is the remaining 1/4 of the blood that gets squeezed out of your heart during systole is going to be pushed by the myocardia of the atria through those atrioventricular valves into the ventricles. From there, we're ready for ventricular systole. Ventricular systole is the well-coordinated contraction of the myocardium of the ventricles, which squeezes blood out through the semilunar valves and into the pulmonary trunk and the aorta. The rate and timing of the myocardium is controlled through two processes. There's extrinsic and intrinsic regulation. Extrinsic, we'll talk about shortly. Intrinsic is an autorhythmic control of the myocardium by the myocardium. And so this is a process that starts in autorhythmic cardiomyocytes clustered in the right atrium called the sinoatrial or SA node. That sinoatrial node has an intrinsic rate of about 100 beats per minute. And that's going to cause a depolarization of the connected cardiomyocytes that spreads across the atria so that we have well-orchestrated contraction during atrial systole. And then that rate is going to affect the atrioventricular, or AV node for short. The heart is actually amazingly well insulated, and so we have a buffer between the atria and the ventricles formed of connective tissue. We call this the fibrous skeleton of the heart. And it's within this fibrous skeleton of the heart that the valves are anchored. But we have one interruption, and that's at the AV node. And so action potentials propagated from the sinoatrial node can then affect the AV node. And from that AV node, we have a conduction along cardiomyocytes called the atrioventricular or AV bundle. That AV bundle breaks up into right and left bundle branches. And from those bundle branches, we have Purkinje fibers originate. And it's these Purkinje fibers that are going to innervate and cause the trabecular carinae and the papillary muscles to fire. Now, each of these regions has their own intrinsic rate of depolarization. So the SA node, as you recall me saying, is 100 beats per minute. The AV node is about 40 to 60 beats per minute. And even the AV bundle and these bundle branches will have an intrinsic rate of about 20 to 35 beats per minute. So they're going to go through that cardiac cycle approximately that many times. Now again, this is intrinsic rate. And so there aren't a whole lot of people that are going to have a heart rate of 100 beats per minute. In fact, that's rather fast. And so what we have controlling this is an extrinsic means of control called the cardiac plexus. The cardiac plexus is an autonomic plexus that's going to help us to maintain normal sinus rhythm and then adjust heart rate depending upon metabolic needs. And those metabolic needs are determined by your level of activity. So this is extrinsic control. So your normal sinus rhythm, so you not engaged in any particularly strenuous activity, is about 60 to 100 beats per minute. So for a lot of people, this is going to fall around 75 beats per minute. So if you were to take your pulse at the carotid sinus or at your radial artery, and you were to count the number of times you felt a throb in a minute, this would be your pulse rate, which corresponds to the rate of cardiac cycles. So normal sinus rhythm, 60 to 100 beats per minute. Anything above 100 beats per minute is what we call tachycardia, so that's a fast heart. Anything below 60 beats per minute is bradycardia, so that's a slow rate of the heart. The cardiac plexus receives inputs from two sources, sympathetic and a parasympathetic. From the sympathetic, we have cardiac nerves, sometimes referred to as cardiac accelerator nerves. These are coming down from the cervical sympathetic chain, and they're actually on both sides. From the parasympathetic, we have branches from the vagus nerves. And they come together in a meshwork of nerves that surround the concavity of the aorta superficially. So this would be the superficial cardiac plexus. And around the division of the trachea into the primary bronchi. So that would be the deep portion of the cardiac plexus. Now these two superficial and deep cardiac plexuses are contiguous. So they communicate with one another. And they help to establish that extrinsic rate, so how fast your heart should be beating. Now, your autonomic nervous system, as you may recall, has two major divisions. There's the sympathetic, that's the fight or flight, and the parasympathetic, that's the rest and digest. And so those cardiac nerves of the sympathetic division are going to elevate heart rate. The vagus branches from the parasympathetic are going to help depress heart rate. So keeping in mind that the intrinsic rate of the SA node is about 100 beats per minute, during normal sinus rhythm, what you're experiencing is a depression of that rate, complements of branches from the vagus nerve. So your parasympathetic outflow is helping you to maintain a lower heart rate than you would need for a given circumstance. Now, during the cardiac cycle, during the what we're going to have are different valves opening and closing in concert with what the myocardium is doing. Now, valves opening and closing are going to be entirely pressure driven. So during diastole, during relaxation of the heart, we want to get as much blood into the ventricles as possible. And as a consequence, those atrioventricular valves are wide open. Now, at the same time, as the ventricles are expanding during diastole and blood is flowing into them through the atria, we don't want pressure to regurgitate blood backwards from the pulmonary trunk or the aorta into the ventricles, and so those semilunar valves are closed shut. In fact, those semilunar valves close because blood being pulled backwards, owing to a decrease in pressure of the ventricles, catches these little cusps of the semilunar valves and pulls them into approximation with one another. Now, during systole, or specifically during ventricular systole, these atrioventricular valves, they're going to close tightly. And it's actually because of the buildup of pressure that these valves get pushed into approximation with one another. They don't flop backwards because, as you may recall from anterior cardiac anatomy, we have chordae tendineae that attach to papillary muscles within the ventricles that helps pull down the leaflets of those valves. Now, we can see over here that during systole or during ventricular systole, blood just pushes its way through these semilunar valves. Whereas during diastole, the blood helps to approximate those valves. One additional thing that you want to realize about diastole is that it's during diastole that blood is going to flow into the coronary arteries. It will travel down the ascending aorta into the aortic sinus and then into the coronary artery. Finally, let's talk a little bit about auscultation. Auscultation is the process of a healthcare provider listening to your body. An auscultation of the heart or of its valves is performed in specific regions. Now, there are four different valves and therefore four different auscultation sites for the functioning of those valves. One thing to keep in mind is that because you're listening, the sound is being conducted through the fluid medium of the blood in the direction that the valve travels. And so here we can see the aortic valve. Here we can see the semilunar pulmonary valve. There's the tricuspid valve and the bicuspid valve. And you need to chart a course along the direction of blood flow from those valves to the nearest projection on the thoracic wall. And so for the semilunar valves, the auscultation sites are going to flank the sternum. So there's the sternum. They're going to be about 3 centimeters off of the midline. The aortic valve is in the second intercostal space, and the aortic will be on the right side, and the pulmonary will be on the left side. The atrioventricular valves are a little trickier. So for the tricuspid valve, which is the most variable, we want to go down to the 5th intercostal space, just adjacent to the sternum. And that's the first place that a provider will look. But you may go down into the costal angle below to look for the tricuspid valve as well. The bicuspid valve is a little more straightforward. It's also in that left 5th intercostal space, about 9 centimeters away from the midline. With practice, these auscultation sites come naturally, almost automatically. But take some time, palpate to find the intercostal spaces, palpate your manubrium, your sternum. When you palpate the sternal angle here, below that is your 2nd intercostal space. And to find the 5th intercostal space, you can go where your xiphoid process is, go laterally, and then go up approximately 1 intercostal space, and you'll be able to find those regions on the left side. So we've talked a little bit about how the heart functions, the cardiac cycle, what the valves are doing during that cardiac cycle, what's driving the cardiac cycle in terms of either intrinsic rates or extrinsic rates of regulation, and what the coronary arteries are doing during that cardiac cycle, and then finally, how to listen or auscultate the heart. Thank you.